Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Yes, I guess you can, for sure. They told me that the green mic means that it's on, the orange mic means that it's off. But I said I'm colorblind and I can't tell the difference, so I'm not making this up. Our genius sound technician said, I'm just going to go ahead and take care of that for you, Stuart. Don't worry about it. Anyway, thank you for coming tonight. I'm going to talk a little bit about each composer. I guess the mic is gone now. But no. Hello. Yes. Okay, good. Thank you. Even though you have program notes, which you're welcome to read, it's dark, and usually people like to hear me talk about it rather than read about it. Maybe it's more interesting that way, even though I did write the program notes, so those are my thoughts too. The first composer tonight, I've been working on his music for probably 20 years now. He worked for Louis XIV, King of France, in the late 1600s. And he lived at Versailles, which is the huge palace outside of Paris. And so his duties there were many. I sort of think in a strange way, his life is not unlike mine. He taught lessons to the king and the queen and the staff during the day. He played in ensembles. He played guitar. He played lute in various ensembles at the palace. And then he performed at night, and there are days where I think, gee, that sort of sounds exactly like my life. Except he didn't have to do a lot of online grading that I have to do, so he had that advantage over me. Anyway, this is the 10th suite. It's actually half of the 10th suite of Robert de Vissey. It's a really long suite, so I'm only playing the second half that I'm about to record for you tonight. And there are 12 of these. This is number 10, written in 1686. So imagine yourself 330 years ago in a huge castle in France in the night, and you're the king of France about to go to bed, and this is something like this is what you'd probably be hearing as you fell asleep. So enjoy. Thank you. Thank you for that.
Hopefully you're still awake.
Contrary to what would have happened in the King's bedchambers, now you have to wake up and listen to the rest of the concert. Whereas Louis would have been drifting away already. All right, the next composer on the program tonight is Domenico Scarlatti, who was an Italian harpsichordist. And in fact, you're going to hear two sonatas by him now and two sonatas by him at the end of the concert. I divide them up so you don't get sick of hearing the same thing over and over again. Actually, I think it's more audience friendly that way. Anyway, he wrote 555 of these little sonatas, as he calls them. They're basically in two parts. There's an A section and a B section. They often are repeated. I will not be taking the repeats tonight because they're pretty long without them. So because Scarlatti got hired by the Queen of Portugal, who then got married to the King of Spain, she took him with her to Spain, and he was surrounded by a lot of guitar music in Spain, and so he kind of began trying to imitate the guitar on its harpsichord. And by the way, harpsichord is the ancestor of the piano, in case you don't know that. I shouldn't assume that you know that. It's like an ancient piano. So he began imitating guitar, kind of, on the piano, and the sounds of Spain came out on his harpsichord, but that allows us to take them back as a guitar player, and it works. It works on guitar, not without a tremendous amount of work, sometimes pain. Anyway, the first one that you're going to hear was actually, we call it transcribed from the harpsichord to the guitar by a Brazilian guitarist by the name of Carlos Barbosa Lima back in the 1970s. I've had to edit it heavily because there are things about it that I felt weren't done as well as I wanted them to be. No offense to him, he's a great player. And whatever, other stuff. The second one was transcribed by one of my former graduate students. It was a project that he did. And so with my guidance, he took it from the harpsichord music and put it on the guitar, and he's here tonight, somewhere lurking out there in the darkness. I asked him, since I thought it was pretty cool, if I could actually play it, and he said, sure. He's not playing it anymore himself, so I'm playing it. His name is Sean Bliss, so I'm giving you credit, Sean, for transcribing this sonata for guitar. One final note as well. The tempo markings on these are not exactly what I'm going to be playing tonight. I mean, I gave you the true tempo markings, but it's really hard to play as fast on guitar as you can on harpsichord, so you have to sort of bring the tempos down a bit. So if you see presto, just pretend like it's presto. It's not going to be presto, though. Anyway, enjoy. Thank you. Thank you for that. Hopefully that was a little more keeping you awake than the previous stuff was. So when I was a teenager in my little town of Chardon, Ohio, which is where I was from, Chardon, Ohio, it's a little tiny town outside of Cleveland. And this was way back before YouTube and the internet and all those crazy things that you've all grown up with. I would go to my public library, and there was two records, actual vinyl records of classical guitar music there. And one of them was Julian Bream, a great English guitarist, recording the Villa-Lobos Etudes. And that's the next composer on your program tonight, Heitor Villa-Lobos, who was Brazilian. And I remember checking that record out. It's probably the only one in my town. Probably nobody's checked it out since I left, like 30 years ago. And I would put it on and listen to it at night and wonder how anybody could play that stuff, it seems. I mean, I already played guitar at the time, but I hadn't begun studying this kind of guitar playing. And still, really, I think it's still my favorite album to this day. It's a beautiful guitar. He played on a very famous guitar. And the fact is that these pieces for guitar, written by Villa-Lobos, who was a guitar player himself, really fit on the instrument beautifully. And he wrote these, you know, this whole idea of etude, which means study. What does that really mean? I mean, I'm not going to be sitting here practicing scales, so don't worry. They're concert studies. They're really almost pieces of music that don't have to be called studies, but I guess there's things in each one that you're supposed to be working on to get better, I suppose. That's the whole idea behind concert studies anyway. There are 12. I've picked three for you tonight. Number 8, number 5, and number 9. They're my favorite. I shouldn't say they're my favorite. They're my favorite to play, judging by how I play myself. But I love to listen to the other 9 as well, and have played some of them. So anyway, I guess I don't have anything else to say. This, I hadn't played these in a while. I do have one more thing to say. I hadn't played these in a long time, and I went to visit my hometown with my wife a couple of years ago, and she had never been there before. My wife is Japanese, and she said, "I want to go to Ohio and see, like, you know, the real America, Stuart." So I started reminiscing about my youth and learning how to play guitar, and I thought, you know, I really miss playing those pieces that first exposed me to the classical guitar, and that was these. So I hope I can give you some of that magic dust that was given to me that year, those 2 years that I listened to them. Thank you.
Thank you.
think it's really hard to get out on the guitar, in case you care.
I keep thinking I'm going to smash my beautiful instrument
onto the ground. Well, I've already told you about Scarlatti, so I don't know what else I can say. Thank you for coming. It's almost over. The last two, sure, I'll tell you a little bit more detail about the final two sonatas. Both of these I did myself, without the help of anyone. The last one I didn't think was possible to do, but I loved the piece so much that for many years I struggled to kind of make it a reality on the guitar, which it is now, for good or bad. But I think it's a pretty cool piece. I think these final two sonatas by Scarlatti perhaps capture a strange sort of he almost had multiple personalities, let me put it to you that way. He'll change, you know, just I'm doing this, then I'm doing this, then I'm doing this. He's very hard to predict, which is part of what I really like about his music. It can sound as happy can be, and then it just sounds evil, and you don't know how that happened or what was going through his mind at the time. But I think these last two pieces can kind of show that. Thank you for spending the evening with me, and I hope you learned a little bit and hopefully enjoyed yourself too. So enjoy the last two pieces.
Difficult tonight, so I don't want to play out of tune. Just give me a minute here.